safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. There by his love are shaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. Hark, 'tis the voice of angels, born in a song to me. Over the fields of glory, over the jasper sea, safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. There by his love are shaded, sweetly my soul shall. Jesus, my heart's dear refuge, Jesus has died for me. Firm on the rock of ages, ever my trust shall be. Here let me wait with patience, wait till the night is o'er, wait till I see the morning break on the golden shore. Safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. There by his love are shaded, sweetly my soul.
One Canadian morning, two fine musicians from the U.S. came and asked Mother Shea to accompany them on the piano. A five-year-old Bev stood transfixed by their side as they sang a song. They said it was new. On a hill far away, the emblem of suffering.
Good afternoon, and we welcome you in this beautiful auditorium for this service and celebration of the life of George Beverly Shea. And in this place this afternoon, we seek to honor his life by giving glory to our Heavenly Father and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It was Jesus himself who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Continuing our worship is our prayer of invocation by Mr. and Mrs. Shea's longtime pastor, the pastor of the Christ Community Church in Montreat, Pastor Richard White.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we have come as far as we can go in this life with one we love, Bev Shea. We gather before you in this hour to pay our respects and to celebrate Bev's life. And what a life. Father, you have blessed every one of us here in some way through Bev. He was a giant among us. A very great man in every respect. But we don't celebrate Bev alone, and he wouldn't want us to. For that would be to miss the entire point of his life. Because there is one greater still, and it is you, Lord Jesus, the one of whom Bev sang all his life, and the one to whom Bev's life continually pointed. It is because of you, Lord Jesus, that we may truly celebrate today. Death is not the final word. You are. For you are the resurrection and the life. You are our hope of eternal joy. We may say boldly with Scripture, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, Lord, we praise you. By your death, you've destroyed the power of death. By your resurrection, you've opened the gates of heaven to your people. The cross and tomb are empty. Jesus lives. And so shall Bev, and so shall we. Blessed be your name, O Lord. But it is difficult saying goodbye and letting go the voice, the smile, the laughter, and the precious embrace of loved ones. And so we ask that as through Bev's life, so now through his death, may we see you, Jesus. Pour out your Spirit upon us, comfort us with your love, strengthen our faith with your gospel, speak to us all of eternal things, and lift us above any sadness this day into the peace and joy of your presence. This we ask in the name that is above all other names, even Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
In making preparation for this day, Carly and Shea said, Tom, I want us to sing some wonderful hymns that Bev loved so much. And he loved to hear hymns sung, and he loved to sing them himself. So on your program, you have three hymns that we've selected. The words are there. We want this to be a victorious time, a praising time. So I'm going to ask you to stand as you join with the choir and as we sing these three hymns in honoring our Lord and Savior.
Oh, Thank you all for coming today. I know that you've come far, and I look out and I see some familiar faces. Many of you knew Dad. Some of you were friends with him. Some of you had heard him sing. But he was a man of special kindness to everyone. And I just want to thank Carlene today. She was a wonderful wife, encourager, and eventually a caretaker that took care of my dad. In fact, the whole family would take time to be with him so he'd never be alone, so he'd always have somebody to talk to. And we loved doing that because he had wonderful stories. You know, Dad grew up in Ottawa, Canada. There's a wonderful Mountie here today, came all the way from Ottawa to represent the Canadian government, and he would have loved that because he wanted to be a Mountie himself. But he often said he didn't go through with it because they thought they'd put him up in Yellowknife for many years and he'd never see civilization again. So he grew up in Ottawa, son of a pastor, and he and his best friend, Asa McIntosh, used to have a fun together. They'd get an empty wallet and they'd tie a string on it and they'd throw it on the sidewalk and hide behind the bushes and see who would come by and try to pick it up, and then they'd pull it. And they thought that was great fun. Later on, Asa's mother asked little Bev, he was 16, because Asa passed away, and Dad played an old pipe organ, the foot pedal, at his funeral, his friend, and it was Safe in the Arms of Jesus by Fanny Crosby, and we heard that coming in today. So it isn't quite appropriate. His first public performance was playing that song. He was a wonderful man. He loved so many people. He was simple. He was funny. He loved going to his cottage in Canada. 50 years old now, and it's just plywood put together. He loved going there. You couldn't stay there in the winter. You'd freeze to death. But he loved going there, and I thought about this the other day, that the simplicity of the structure of that building helped it survive all these years in the Canadian woods. And, you know, that's what Dad's life was. He was simple. He loved the Lord. He knew music. He loved singing praises. And we loved him for it. So thank you, Dad. You're in a great place.
I'm Steve Aceto. My sister Nancy Edwards and I are Carlene Shea's children, and we're Bev Shea's stepchildren. And we thank you all for joining us here today, and we especially thank the people of Billy Graham Evangelistic Association and the town of Montreat, who have planned and worked so hard on all that you see here. About 27 years ago, a world famous and highly accomplished man who was twice my age came to me and asked for permission to marry my mother. Well, this confused me at first. But I have since come to understand that this was the gift of a Christ-like man showing me something of what God is like: humility and deference with a sense of humor. See, God is humble. God the Holy Spirit speaks to us in words. God the Father makes covenants, makes contracts. He makes deals with people who can't possibly perform their end of the bargain. But he still keeps his part, and ours as well. And God the Son showed up in human flesh and allowed himself to be put to death, and then rose from the dead. And now he stands at the door and knocks. And he seeks to make himself known to each of us. And God humbly seeks to make us a part of his family by granting us faith. And this puts me in mind of how Bev made us part of his family. It may sound odd to those of you who have known Bev for many years before Nancy and I did, but our children and their friends called Bev Papa Shea. And Bev was at all times and in every way that I can think of a loving husband to our mother. He was a doting grandfather to our children. He was an engaging father-in-law to our spouses. He was our nearest father, and he was our dear friend. And at all times, and in every way I can think of, Bev's family, who came before us, has been gracious in receiving us. This has been my family's great privilege. For this man's great example, for all of us, we are ourselves humbled, and we're grateful to God. I like to think that at the end of days, when I see Jesus face to face, there will be something about him that seems familiar because of something that someone said to me or did to me while I was in this life. And I wish that that would be the case for my wife and my children, even a stranger that I meet. And certainly that will be the case with Bev Shea, that there will be something about Jesus that seems familiar. And we would ask this for each one of you, that you would likewise be able to reflect that to the people in your life, and that we would all experience this. And for that, we're grateful. Thank you again.
Lord, thou hast here thy 99. Are they not enough for thee? But the shepherd made answer, This of mine has wandered away from me, and although the road be rough and steep, I go to the desert to find my sheep. But none of the ransomed ever knew how deep were the waters crossed, nor how dark was the night that the Lord passed through ere he found his sheep that was lost. Out in the desert, he heard its cry, sick and helpless and ready to die. Lord, whence are those blood drops all the way that mark out the mountain's track? They were shed for one who had gone astray ere the shepherd could bring him back. Lord, whence are thy hands so rent and torn? They are pierced tonight by many a thorn. But all to the mountains thunder-riven, and up from the rocky steep, there arose a glad cry to the gates of heaven. Rejoice, I have found my sheep. And the angels echoed around the throne, Rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own. Rejoice, rejoice,
I don't live the way I used to, and my heart has been a change. I can tell there's something different, and my life won't be the same. If you ask, I'll gladly tell you how it all came to be. Well, the answer is so simple. I've been touched by Calvary. I've been washed in His precious blood, saved by His boundless love, filled with His Spirit. My soul's been set free. By His mercy and amazing grace, I'll see my Savior face to face. Praise His name. I've been touched by Calvary. I can feel His mighty presence as I live from day to day, and I know He's there beside me to guide each step I take. Oh, I don't worry about tomorrow, 'cause in my heart I am at peace. Oh, I've been blessed beyond all measure by the touch of Calvary. I've been washed in His precious blood, saved by His boundless love, filled with His Spirit. My soul's been set free. By His mercy and amazing grace, I'll see my Savior face to face. Praise His name. I've been touched by Calvary. Oh, praise His name. I've been touched by Calvary. Calvary.
Thank you, Quartet. What a privilege for me today to be able to pay the team's respect to a man whom we came to know as a gentle giant. Our dear beloved friend, for many, many years, George Beverly Shea. For nearly 70 years, I would have the privilege of saying, before the message tonight, here's our beloved, America's beloved gospel singer, George Beverly Shea, to sing for you. And oh my, how the people would perk up and listen. They were anxious to hear what Billy spoke, but they were just as anxious to hear what Bev had to say in his song. And Billy would hold the Bibles up one night after another and say, how many brought your Bibles tonight? And they'd be all over the place. But Bev didn't have a Bible to raise. He had a voice to raise. And as he sang the songs so specifically and very clearly pronounced the words, people listened and they were ready. And I will never forget, one of his favorite songs was John Peterson's It Took a Miracle to Hang the World in Space, to put the stars in place. On the second night of our meeting in Haringey in London, England, he sang that song, and Bev was very clear, I thought, in his pronunciation. But Mr. Graham got a card in the mail the next day. He said, Mr. Graham, don't you think it's presumptuous for your soloist to come from America and sing It Took America to Put the Stars in Place? It took America to Hang the World in Space. Oh. And he said, well, I'll have to watch my diction from now on. And you never had to wonder what Bev would sing. His words were so clear, so perfect. You know, his dear friend Roy Gustafson made this statement, and he was known by Bill and all of us on the team. In fact, he passed away just 10 years ago, last week. But he said when Bev was born, he was given such a dose of humility, he's been living in relapse ever since. And I think that's true. In writing the book Prophet with Honor, William Martin was in Dallas, Texas. And it was after the service, and Bev was in the dining room eating a bowl of soup or something and saying everything he could to people who came in. And Mr. Martin went over to him and he said, Bev, your voice is so strong. It just rolled out so beautifully like a warm blanket over the whole audience tonight. And Bev, with a twinkle in his eye, said, oh, thank you. But he said, I thought I sounded better when I was 90. Oh, well, what a precious, precious man. He was a giant in his legacy that he had left by his mother and daddy. His daddy taught him the violin, and his mother worked on little chords on the piano so he could learn to play, and he played by ear most of the time. And they knew that he had a love for music, and Maud Wintley was his mother. He was one of eight children, and she encouraged as much music as she could. He won another amateur hour in New York. And a man who was a pastor of Calvary Baptist Church, where he used to sing, became the president of Moody Bible Institute and said, Mr. Shea, have you ever considered a lifetime music ministry of singing the gospel? And that started Bev thinking, and he invited him to come to WMBI, the radio station. And it was there that he began on Club Time, a hymn a program of hymns across America. And it was there that Mr. Graham went to his office one day and asked him, he said, I want to meet you. I want to thank you for your ministry of music. You're known and loved all over this town and this city and this country. And would you come and join with me in a radio program? I'm going to have songs in the night. And that's when Bev said yes, he would do it. He would do this. And then it was just a few years later when he asked Bev if he would come and join with us as we were going to be forming a team, and we were going to be in Charlotte for our first crusade. And he asked Bev if he would come and sing, and Bev said, well, Mr. Graham, most soloists I've heard, they'd sing a verse or two and then they'd talk a little bit. Would I have to do that? And Billy said, I hope not. Well, Bev came, and that began a lifelong relationship. What a joy to be with this gentle giant. And whenever Bev got into town, we would relax because we knew that whatever took place on the platform, before Billy Graham spoke, Bev would be used by the Spirit of God to prepare the hearts of the people for the message, and he would prepare Billy's heart to preach that message. And I was there to be with him and to sit by his side, and sometimes the Spirit of God would speak to him in the sitting in the service. He said, I'd like to change my song. But we couldn't tell the pianist, Ted Smith or Don Husted or John Innes or Bill Fazley, because they were at the instruments. So he devised a little plan. He said, well, I'll just give them my finger signals. If I hold them down, that's two flats. If I hold them up, that's two sharps. And he gave the signal of the key by the fingers. Three fingers would be E flat, or four would be A flat. And they just get in the key, and they didn't know what he was going to sing. But Bev knew. And Billy said, I'd rather hear Bev Shea sing than any other person in the world. And so would we all. And so would we all. God bless that man. One of our most happy times in recent years has been at the Cove on Tuesday night, when we'd sit and talk and reflect and talk about experiences we've had. And it'd be interesting. I could get Bev to talk about almost anything he wanted to talk about. We let him kind of set the pace. Sometimes it'd be about organs, the last organ that he acquired. And one day we had Randy come, and he played all the organs in the house. He had about eight of them, I think. He went around from one to another, and he loved his organs. And then he loved coffee. Oh, boy. He had his own gauge from 1 to 10. And usually at mid-morning, we'd meet down in the coffee shop, and we'd have a cup of coffee together, and we'd say, Bev, what do you feel like singing tonight? And we'd talk about it, and we'd talk to the musicians, and we had it all set. But then when he would sing, God prepared the hearts of the people for the response. And afterwards, on those Tuesday night specials, sometimes he'd ask me to sing a duet with him. Boy, that was something, man. I always wanted to sing with Bev, but I never felt I could even begin to get the notes right. But we had a song, Jesus Whispers Peace. There is a name to me most dear, like sweetest music to my ear. And when my heart is troubled, filled with fear, Jesus whispers peace. When grief seems more than I can bear, my soul weighed down with heavy care, and I am sorely tempted to despair, Jesus whispers peace. Oh, that the world might hear him speak the words of comfort that men seek, to all the lowly and to all the meek, Jesus whispers peace. Well, I tell you, Bev has changed his backup group from a crusade choir to Bill and Gloria Gaither's homecoming choir, most of whom are in heaven now. And they've been waiting for Bev to come, their favorite soloist, so he could sing with them. But they're singing about making Christ known and loved, bowing at his feet and worshiping him. And tonight, today, Ron has already expressed it, but Carlene, thank you for your loving care to our dear friend. Your care and the love of the family has meant so much to us all. And he would say to you and to all of us tonight, we'll soon be in heaven together, and we'll soon be singing the praises of our wonderful Lord. I was with Mr. Graham the day after he had passed away, and Bill and I were sitting there talking together, and I said, Bill, we've lost a third member of our trio. And you and I don't sound too good together just as a duet. But we'll soon be in heaven with him, and we'll sing it again. And we'll be reminded to all of you today the gentle giant, gentle in his loving care, gentle in the way he would encourage people. We'd have new artists come to the crusade, and some of them would be scared to death that they were going to have to sing in that meeting, and the place would be jammed. And Bev would disarm them immediately by his smile, the twinkle in his eye, his gentle big laughter, and he'd make them feel right at home. And they were able to carry on. And we know that God has used him to cause many hundreds of people come to faith in Christ even before the message was given. And we thank God for him. And to think I've had the privilege of working and walking by his side, I shall ever be grateful. And to all of us today, this gentle giant, he was a strong man physically. He could pick up the tongue of his trailer loaded with a boat and move it around and put it on the hitch in the car without any help. He was a man with big bones. You couldn't put your finger around his wrist. He was a big, strong man, but he was strong in heart. He left a great legacy. He inherited one, and he's left one. And we thank God for every remembrance of him. The gentle giant of the team. And remember, Jesus whispers peace to all who experience grief more than we can bear. Our soul weighed down with heavy care. And we think he is gone, but we haven't lost him. He's left the land of the dying for the land of the living. Hallelujah. Praise his name. God bless you all.
Good afternoon. In 1955, George Beverly Shea was crossing the Atlantic Ocean from New York City to England. He was sailing aboard the SS United States, then the fastest passenger liner in the world. Walking one evening on the deck with his son Ron, Mr. Shea met a man whom he recognized as the publisher of a music company in New York City. They soon fell into conversation and found themselves in the interior of the ship because of the breezy deck air. As they talked together that night, Mr. Shea would learn that this man was from a different faith background, and yet they shared their same love for classical music and great hymns of the Christian faith. And soon they began speaking about what Mr. Shea did. They were talking about an upcoming Glasgow, Scotland crusade where Mr. Shea was traveling toward. That's when his newfound friend turned to Mr. Shea and asked him, "Why do so many people attend those great meetings? Why do so many people fill stadiums? What in the world goes on there?" Well, Mr. Shea mentioned the necessary weeks of preparation for such an event. He talked about the incredible volunteer choir that Cliff Barrows would direct. Then he began to speak of the message of God's love extended to everyone who came to those meetings so eloquently preached by Billy Graham. And then he quoted John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." And then George Beverly Shea found himself quickly adding something to that. He said, "Oh, sir, if you could only see it, the wonder of it all." Now, perhaps because this man was a music publisher, this fellow reached into his pocket, pulled out an envelope, and scratched some words on that piece of paper. And then he turned it around, flashed it in front of Mr. Shea, and on it were the words, "The wonder of it all." And then he said, "Mr. Shea, I challenge you to write a song with this title." And Mr. Shea smiled, and saying he'd only written a few in his life, but thanked him warmly. That evening, there was a marvelous sunset over the ocean. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, Mrs. Shea heard the rustle of movement in the room, and she whispered to Bev, "What are you doing?" And he said, "Oh, just working on a little music." And she knew. Sometime between that hour of 2 o'clock and as the sun would rise, while the ship was rolling just a little bit, Mr. Shea found his way to a desk where he wrote the words and the music. "There's the wonder of sunset at evening. The wonder of sunrise I see, but the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me." Well, this afternoon, I want to take a little poetic license with those words. Those of us in Christ can readily identify with the wonder of knowing him and being loved by him. But I suggest, dear Mr. Shea, that we turn the subject matter around just a little bit. Quite frankly, when one considers this man's life, George Beverly Shea, all 104 years of life, then we can in this place today collectively say, why the wonder of it all. One incredible life spent for Jesus Christ. We were privileged, each of us in this room, to see and appreciate this man. We lived when he lived, and we celebrate that life today. The wonder of it all in Bev's life begins with the pronouncement of his life verse. You've seen it in the program today, Psalm 28:7. "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him." That is exactly how Bev Shea lived his life, and he did to the very end of his days. But who was this man? Why was his life so remarkable? What is the wonder of it all today? Well, I believe Mr. Shea's life is best summed up in a variety of distinct phrases and some reflective thoughts about this extraordinary life. I want to suggest to you the wonder of it all. First, the twinkle in his eye. Did you ever meet anyone who enjoyed life with such vitality or who loved people more? I doubt it. There was always something about Mr. Shea's remarkable life. He loved life and he loved people. You could never visit him that he did not demonstrate that twinkle. The joy of life, the power of laughter, and as Cliff has already said, the ever-present cup of coffee. The only thing that rivaled Bev's love for Carlene was his love of Tim Horton coffee from Canada. Bev loved life. No matter if you had heard it before, he would always ask you if you visited, "Have you heard this Rogers organ play?" And as Cliff said, remember, this was a man who had not one electronic organ in his home, but at one time he had 7 or 8. One, in fact, that had pipes that stretched the width of his basement. An unusual man. He loved people, and he loved laughter. Early in his musical career, he'd been known as Beverly Shea. That was perfectly fine until he joined the Musicians Union in Chicago early in his career. And one day he received a note from them that read, "Beverly, the ladies of the union are meeting today at Palmer House Hotel. Come join us and bring your bathing suit." Bev would then add a defining marker to his name. From that moment on, he'd be known as George Beverly Shea. But with that ever-present twinkle, I've often heard him tell that story, and then he would say, "But I should have gone to that pool." Bev loved life, he loved people, and he loved laughter because he loved the Lord. Psalm 63:3 says, "Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you." And that's what Bev Shea did. Not only did you notice the twinkle in his eye, but you distinctly heard the praise on his lips. I speak of the song in his heart. Beyond that twinkle was always that ever-present song. Only someone who knew the Savior, as George Beverly Shea did, could sing like he did. As a young boy myself, growing up in North Carolina, my parents used to put my brother and I to sleep listening to Shea music. We had the full and historic collection of Word record albums. Any of you remember those? I can remember to this day the sound of our stereo phonograph. I think we called it high fidelity in those days. When a record dropped from the record changer onto the turntable and the sound of needles scratching a long play album. Don't you miss that just a little bit? You know, switching on your iPod may be more technically advanced, but I do sometimes miss the sound of spinning records. I'm that old. But the songs of my childhood growing up perhaps were the songs of your childhood too, or of your life. Songs by George Beverly Shea, "The 90 and 9, "The Old Rugged Cross," "I Won't Have to Cross Jordan Alone," "Then Jesus Came," "How Big Is God," "I'd Rather Have Jesus," "It Took a Miracle," or one that I can still sing to this day, "Somebody Bigger Than You and I." And you know, for me, life became so cyclical. When Carrie and I were cleaning out my mother's home some years ago, following her bout with early onset dementia, do you know what I found? I found by her bed a tape player with a cassette. And when I opened it, I found it to be the music of George Beverly Shea. I can't say that our family was especially technical, but I was pleased to learn my mother had moved past long play albums at least to the world of cassettes by that time. But this I know, that in her latter years, when faced with a difficult path, when lonely, when her memories dimmed, and her way grew ever so weary, she too fell asleep listening to the music of George Beverly Shea. Composer, author, singer of songs, George Beverly Shea could say with the psalmist, "The whole earth is filled with awe at your wonders. When morning dawns, when evening fades, you call forth songs of joy." There was a song in Bev's heart. But then I think you have to speak of the length of his days. The psalmist has also said, "With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." 104 years plus. Most of us in this room will be less likely to live that long, for sure, but it's also not commonplace to know anyone who has. Just last year, when he was 103, Bev used to joke and say, 100 years ago, I was 3. Just in the last week before his death, he turned to Carlene one morning and said, 104, why, it can't be. Do you really think I'm alive? Mr. Shea was blessed with that extraordinary life, and he lived every day to the fullest. Coffee cup in hand, Fox News on the TV, and a technical gadget always close by. He loved life. He was especially proud of that Rogers organ that graced his living room. In fact, it is here today. In his day, he would travel far and wide with Carlene just to hear a pipe organ being played. But what of those incredible years? What of those 104 years? Born in Canada, converted at an early age, and later recommitting himself to a life in Christ when confronted with the words of Rhea F. Miller's poem, "I'd Rather Have Jesus." Taught the love of music from a saintly mother and Christian discipleship from a godly father. Growing into musical giftedness and branching out as a featured soloist. Gaining recognition on national radio and beginning his long and illustrious recording career. Then came a young preacher. A young preacher who invited the better-known singer to join him on a local radio program in Chicago called Songs in the Night. Thus began a 70-year friendship between George Beverly Shea and William Franklin Billy Graham. Youth for Christ would follow, later blending into citywide meetings, and along with Cliff Barrows, the three of them would globetrot the world, engaging millions of people on every continent with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Along the way, Mr. Shea would record 70 albums featuring hundreds, if not thousands, of individual songs. He would be nominated for 10 Grammys, winning one in 1966 and later receiving a Lifetime Achievement Award. Guinness Book of Records would define Mr. Shea as the most listened to singer in live performances around the world. What a musical career, what a life, the length of his days. Someone in an earlier day asked him how he would like to be remembered, and Bev quickly said that I always stayed on key. Does that sound like a musician? All along, he was loved, of course, by his first wife, Irma, and their two children, Ron and Elaine, later joined by Kathy and the granddaughter, Elaine's daughter, Tamara, and given a new lease on life by marrying Carlene Aceto in 1985, after Irma had passed away in 1976. Carlene's children, Steve and Nancy, of course, and their extended families, Fran, Bill and Sally, Ben and Tiffany, Kylie and Knox Hampton, and Jack, Matheson and Jeff and Ellis, would surround him with love and affirmation, giving Mr. Shea a new strength to life and enabling him to live joyously into his 11th decade of life. In 2011, at the younger age of 102, even Hollywood acknowledged this incredible life with the presentation of a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Grammy organization. And there on a historic theater stage in Los Angeles, other recipients were honored the same day. And those included Julie Andrews, the Juilliard String Quartet, the Kingston Trio, the Ramones, and the incomparable Dolly Parton. And there sat Mr. Shea in his wheelchair, uncomfortably receiving a standing ovation from all of those people who were in the same business of music, but not quite his peer. Yet even in jaded Hollywood, a place not well known for faith statements or gospel truth necessarily, they honored this man for what he did. And what he did was to sing songs about Jesus Christ. And they took note of his life, a life well lived from a most incredible and humble heart. And God was glorified on that day at the Bell Theater in Los Angeles. But Mr. Shea, in typical fashion, told those glittering guests who peered at him on stage. And he said this, that being there that day was like the experience of the farmer who entered his donkey in the Kentucky Derby. They said to him, well, what do you expect, farmer? You won't win, said the detractors. No, the farmer said, my mule won't win, but look at the company he'll keep. That's how he felt that day. Oh, the length of his days, 104 years. But finally, to understand this man is to understand the joy of his Lord. What of this man? And what of his life? For all the accolades so appropriately bestowed on this one life, it all began with a simple yet profound belief, a trust in a Savior, even Jesus Christ, who gave George Beverly Shea reason for living and definitive purpose in life. Without Jesus, Bev Shea may well have been a singer, but not a singer of eternal significance as he's well remembered today. Without Jesus, we most likely would not have been here today, speaking of the humble graces of one whom we honor in this place. Without Jesus, there well may be no successive Christian generations that are so beautifully modeled in this family sitting here. Without Jesus Christ, there'd be no joy in our singing, no power in our words, and no eternal destiny that Mr. Shea so wonderfully experiences and knows firsthand today. It is Jesus. What a Savior. And Mr. Shea would expect from this pulpit today a clarion call to that truth, that each one of us in this room must face the consequences of sin and the need for a loving Savior. Do you know him today? Do you know him? If you know Jesus, you can fully recognize the Jesus life that Mr. Shea lived. He loved hymns and psalms and spiritual songs. He loved singers, and he especially loved hymn writers, some of whom are here with us to celebrate his life. Longtime friends like Don Husted and Kurt Kaiser. But another such songwriter is here, Gloria Gaither. And along with Bill, these are persons whom Mr. Shea loved so very much, and they loved him as well. Gloria wrote some time ago about Bill's own aged grandmother, a saintly lady named Mom Hartwell. Gloria wrote, "We watched Mom slip from us. At times she'd be delirious, partly from stroke and partly from medication. And as we sat by her bedside, she would sing in her delirium old songs about her precious Jesus. Oh, she'd sing, Jesus is so precious to me. Yes, he's precious to me. Sometimes Mom Hartwell would mumble words barely audible. Glory would say they'd lean close to listen. They'd hear her whisper, Jesus, how good he is, Jesus. One day, Gloria writes, toward the end of Mom Hartwell's life, she was lucid and able to talk to them. They all sat by the bed, Bill and Gloria, and at the time, their baby girl, Suzanne. Mom Hartwell loved to see babies. She was recalling with them both moments of good and difficult in her life. Then after a while, Bill said to her, "Mom, you've lived a long life. We're just starting out with our baby and our lives. Tell me, is it worth serving Jesus all these years?" And Mom Hartwell looked at him with the Irish twinkle in those still snappy brown eyes, and she said this, "Billy, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows." Not long after that, according to Gloria, still forming the name of Jesus with her lips, she slipped out of their arms and into his. And by then, the words that she had left had worked themselves into a song, and it was published with the title, "The Longer I Serve Him." Now, interestingly, years later, George Beverly Shea would record that very same song. In fact, as I think about it today, it's the remarkable testimony not only of Mom Hartwell, but certainly that of George Beverly Shea. Because the unmistakable truth is this: the longer we serve Jesus, the sweeter he becomes. But just as true is this: the longer one serves him, the sweeter one becomes. It's a remarkable spiritual truth. So it was with George Beverly Shea. The sweetness never dimmed. The twinkle never left. The song did not depart from his life. And until his dying day, the longer Mr. Shea served Jesus, the sweeter Mr. Shea became. And Mr. Shea would sing, "Since I started for the kingdom, since my life he controls, since I gave my heart to Jesus, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Every need God is supplying, plenteous grace he bestows. Every day my way gets brighter. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows." So it was with George Beverly Shea. A life well lived, a song completely sung, a heart that overflowed, and a countenance and spirit that reflected the joy of knowing Jesus Christ. The Lord has given. The Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
just a few minutes, we'll have our closing prayer, led by Will Graham. But I want to just give a couple of instructions, if you don't mind. As we prepare to leave, Carlene Shea and Ron Shea have expressed interest of saying hello to those of you that are dear friends that are here today, that have come to pay your respects to George Beverly Shea and the family. And they're going to be right here in the front. And so we're asking that as we have the final spoken benediction, there'll also be a musical benediction. And then we're going to ask, if you will, the ushers will be in the aisle, and they will try to let you come quickly after the casket is gone. And also some of the grandchildren, I understand, will be at the exit door here. If you need to exit quickly, you can do that. Some of them will be there to greet you as you go. But Carlene and Ron will be here. Some of the other family members will be here in the front. And we would appreciate you orderly coming around us to give your respects. So we'll ask, if you will, to listen, and we'll give you a cue at the close after we've completely finished, and then you may come. Will you come?
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we confess today that you are good. Even in the midst of sadness, we realize and confess your goodness. Though our eyes weep, our hearts rejoice in you. Thank you for your goodness to us. And we gather together to say thank you for the life of George Beverly Shea. Thank you for this gentle giant of a man who walked among us. Thank you for this man of God who proclaimed your truth through music and song. Thank you for this man who was a faithful husband. And we pray especially for Carlene, that you would comfort her during this time. We thank you for this man who was called brother. And we pray for Alton Shea and Ruth Willett. And we thank you for this man who is called father, grandfather, great-grandfather. And so we pray for Ron and Elaine, and we pray for the Aceto family as well as the Edwards family. Thank you for this man who is called a dear friend. We, like the rest of us in here, already miss our friend. But we look in anticipation to seeing him again. Thank you for this man who loved all of us and made each of us feel like we were one of his. Help us to love others like he loved each of us. Lord, with our earthly loss, our hearts now yearn for heaven even more so. May we be even more determined to share the love of God, just as Uncle Bev, Papa Shea, did all these years, so others can spend eternity with Christ. Lord, we love you. In the name that conquered death, in the precious name of Jesus, amen.
It is in heaven.
lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Last night I lay a-sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing a hosanna. And I saw the holy city coming down from God, and I heard a great voice saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And then methought my dream was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were opened wide.